You do remember what it looks like, correct? What it feels like to be an SEC fan on a Saturday morning. Oh, we never forget. 8 long months of an offseason. It's about to end, and the party is about to begin. This season may be the year of the running back. What are the chances that one of these SEC workhorses brings the Heisman back home with them? We will size it up for you. And what are we really to make of the quarterback situations in this league? Can these established starters take their teams to the limit? And is there any good coming from these fall camp playing time battles? It is time to find out. The SEC Nation Preview Show has the answers. Like a fluttering moth to an irresistible porch lamp. We cannot stay away. We are back for more and more and more SEC football as we welcome you to the SEC Nation Preview Show. I'm Joe Tessitore. You know Marcus Spears. He was stalking this guy to his left all offseason. You guys, you can't get enough of each other every day on the radio.
I miss him every time I'm gone.
And the newest addition to SEC Nation, hardly new as he's working for SEC Network with everything he does with great aplomb, Greg McElroy. Welcome, Greg.
Thank you, guys. Good to be with y'all. Enjoyed watching you guys last year. Glad to be a part of the team.
We'll see if you still feel that good in a few weeks when you spend a few weeks on the road trapped in a bus with us.
I can't believe I got invited back.
That really is a stunt. You fly in private planes with Saban. You're connected now, Feinbaum. You're very connected. Hey, let's talk biggest storylines in terms of the SEC going into 2015.
I think it's Auburn. They're the preseason pick. I like Auburn. They're a good team. But don't forget, they lost 5 games last year. What's changed other than Will Muschamp?
Will Muschamp is in. This defense will be a lot better this year. And they're a defense away from possibly being national champions. But now that I talk about defense, I have to talk about Bama. The tide will roll this year. This front seven is monstrous. We know who the guys are. Nick Saban and Kirby Smart leading the way on the defensive side of the football. It could spell trouble for a lot of opponents this year.
Yeah, but those opponents are pretty good. If you look at it, all the SEC West teams received multiple votes to win the division. The coaching staffs are excellent. The offenses are fantastic. Great play at the line of scrimmage. Multiple different playmakers at several different positions. Every team in the West has a chance to win it.
Listen, my biggest storyline is this. Did 1 year into the new college football playoff just change everything? This isn't the BCS, and it wasn't so pretty for the SEC. The thought of getting 2 teams into the new postseason format, it just feels very distant after just 1 year of a sample size of how the selection committee operates. Remember, we didn't know last year. We were projecting that there was a path to getting 2 SEC teams in. You just don't feel as good about it right now with this new world order. So what is at stake now for this conference?
Well, the SEC is no longer going to get the benefit of the doubt. The way things went in the bowl season a year ago, the SEC West didn't look good, and most notably against ranked opponents. So the SEC, maybe in the BCS era, against the other 4 Power 5 conferences, would have gotten probably a little bit of a leg up. No longer the case after the first season in the college football
I have
playoff.
To believe strength of schedule still matters. And if you have 2 teams that emerge out of this conference as top-tier type football teams, it has to be a long, hard conversation. We had this talk last year, though. I don't think it's good for a college football playoff to have two teams represent from one conference. It played out great last year. I think they'll try to keep that format. The SEC is so tough.
Looking like a true LSU graduate.
Yeah. You know, strength of schedule matters, but Paul, obviously they're valuing conference championships a heck of a lot. I mean, look at how it played out.
Yeah, I mean, going back to what Greg said, I think the SEC's myth or mystique has been shattered. And at the risk of being ejected out of the seat here at the SEC Network, I think the SEC has a lot to prove this year. It doesn't have to win the national championship, but what if it loses to Ohio State or doesn't even make the 4-team playoff? I think it gets worse.
The other day, I'm listening to you on your national radio show, and there was almost a sense of desperation of saying, how is the SEC? The SEC has to find a team that'll be there in the postseason.
Yes, because what this conference has always had, and there's been parity, there's been good teams that have come up and knocked off national championship contenders, but they've always had the best team in the last 8-10 years, potentially, in the game. They've always had it, and they no longer for sure have the top dog going into the season.
You mentioned parity. Is this going to be a year defined by parity in the SEC, or do you think a true power team emerges and runs out in front? Parity or power team?
It'll be parity. These teams are too tough. Week in, week out, places you have to go play, how you have to compete every week. And for college athletes, sometimes they don't get that week-to-week process of having to prepare, keep your stinger up, and go into a stadium and try to win football games. Super, a tremendous amount of talent in this league, but it's tough to get up every week in this conference against guys that can beat you.
Keep your stinger up? What's that mean?
That's football talk, something you would never
know. Parity or power team this year? Parity or power team?
I'm going to go with Marcus at the risk of getting knocked out of this chair. I think it's parity. I mean, we don't know. We could have a team come out of nowhere. I don't think so, like Auburn did 2 years ago, but I would go with parity.
Yep. From parity to partying. Haley Hartung, you thought you were shocked that you came back. This was the lock as soon as coming back. Kaylee's got the big reveal for us. Hello, Kaylee.
Hey, guys. Well, you know we take the party wherever we go, and every SEC town welcomed us a year ago. That scene in Starkville, I know, is one none of us will soon forget from year one. I mean, Marcus was ready to jump off the set and start marching on that dog walk right onto the field. Well, which crowd will show up and show out in the biggest way in year two? Well, let's find out where we're taking this party. To get the season started, the folks in Fayetteville will get the first shot. SEC Nation will open the season with the Razorback faithful in Victory Village on September 5th. If Jerry Jones shows up, Paul promises not to borrow his sunglasses, but I bet those Razorbacks will like to see the nose on Paul's face again. Now, Joe Tess, you better pack your cowboy boots for week two. As Georgia makes the trip to Music City, so will we. It's our first trip to Vanderbilt's campus, as our set last season was at LP Field, and this year we'll be at the Commons. And hey, it's an early homecoming for Mr. Spears and myself. The importance of a week three matchup between LSU and Auburn is implicit, as is the importance that we all show up in Baton Rouge real hungry, guys.
Spears, I didn't know that Ferragamo makes cowboy boots, but if so, I will wear them. We have our SEC experts panel, from writers to producers to on-air talent. We asked them to vote top fives throughout the night. Top five September games voted by the experts. Number one, Auburn at LSU. We're going to talk more about LSU as the night goes on, a game that could really define their season. Oklahoma at Tennessee, non-conference. You remember what happened a year ago. Here's the back end of that home and home. Still to come, the media made their statement this summer. Auburn should take the title, they said. But are the Tigers ready to answer for all the hype? Speaking of hype, strong finishes last year. The Vols, the Hogs, are they more than just sleepers?
A lot of hard work has gone into it, but we're still a long ways to go. We're still arguably the youngest football team in all of college football.
Finish the play! Finish the play!
Our expectation is to win the SEC, win the SEC East. We always talk about the power of one, taking it one day at a time, and embracing the process as we go. We got to put in the hours and put in the work now to get what we want to succeed in the end.
It's all about the process, and we're still not anywhere where we need to be, but we're making tremendous strides each and every day.
Is Butch allowed to say the process? I need clarification on that, Feinbaum, as we look at Tennessee and Arkansas. Tennessee won 4 of their last 5, Arkansas 3 of their last 4, but held each of its last 5 opponents to just 2 touchdowns. Now, 2 of those Tennessee wins came on the road. 2 of the Arkansas wins were shutouts against ranked opponents, and you know what they did in the bowls. The 45 points on Iowa, for the Vols. Arkansas dismantling Texas. So here you have program trajectory. But whose hype are you buying, Tennessee or Arkansas?
I'm buying Arkansas because it's cheaper. I mean, the Tennessee hype is out of sight right now. But I think it's fairly close. I think Arkansas took a step back this week with the key injury. But on the other hand, though, I think Tennessee has a ways to go. I think Arkansas showed at the end of last season.
You really worried about the Jonathan Williams injury, knowing that Alex Collins, to that extent, Jonathan Williams out for the year?
I think it hurts. I think it hurts.
He's a top-line player, but obviously they have depth at running back.
I think Jonathan Williams is the better back out of him and Collins, but I'm still also buying Arkansas. It's because they can win at the line of scrimmage. And when they have the lead, they can play with it. If you look at Tennessee, yes, I love their defensive ends, but I don't love their defensive tackles. I love Arkansas's defensive line from a depth standpoint and from a scheme standpoint. Defensive coordinator Rob Smith does a terrific job making sure those guys play together, and that offensive line, as big as we have in all of football, the NFL and college alike, will move guys off the football. I love this Arkansas team. I am buying, even though they're in a more difficult West.
Who you got? Tennessee. Arkansas or Tennessee? You
at Tennessee. Volunteers. Absolutely.
There's a lone dissenting vote here.
Talent. And when you look at the quarterback position, a guy that can make this offensive line better. And when I say better, what they lack in, he makes up for in athletic ability. And then you talk about playmakers. Jalen Hurd, Marquez North, Pig Howard on the offensive side of the football. And I got to be honest with you, Greg, this defensive line may be the best in the conference this year. Khalil McKenzie, the incoming freshman at defensive tackle, he's a monster. We've already seen tape of what he can do to destroy people. And Derek Barnett and Kurt Majette, they both had great seasons last year. I think this D-line is formidable, and I think they are game changers.
What about
up
the
front.
Offensive line?
I think the offensive line will be compensated for what Josh Dobbs can do with his feet. You saw the sack percentage go down when he came into the season last year. You saw the scoring go up. You saw the run game get better because they have to respect his wheels. I think this is a better football team because of the skill position at quarterback offensively. And defense, it's not a lot of questions over
Greg
there.
Takes a shot at the defensive tackles. They're young. They probably will play in the NFL 4 years from now. Just right now, they're inexperienced. The guy who's headed right to the league in a couple of years, but a year ago right now, we didn't know. Eric Barnett. I mean, freak alert here with Barnett.
Listen, number 9 is a complete football player. He plays both ends and facets of the game. The run game, as you can see here against Cam Robinson, one of the best left tackles in the game of football in college. He gets off a block, defeats it man-on-man, and has strength enough to make a tackle on Derrick Henry. That's difficult. You talk about motor. You talk about guys not stopping on plays. Derrick Barnett has a continuous motor, and most of the time, guys that play hard the whole game, they fall into plays. And then you look at his signature move, the dip around the corner. Now, he needs to finish this, but look at the end of this play. You tell me that quarterback didn't feel that pressure, which ended up in a tip ball interception. He's a playmaker. And when you have guys like that up front who you have to account for every single play, it makes the other guys on the defensive line better, and it makes you better as a whole on defense. Pressuring quarterbacks always has made the secondary look a lot better than what they really are.
I think this is a fair comparison when you talk about the programs of Arkansas and Tennessee. Let me offer this. Blind resume, gentlemen. Two SEC West teams. Both finished 8-5 last season, replaced their defensive coordinators. One team beat the other team head-to-head on the home field, nonetheless. But the other was picked as the favorite to win the conference, and the other one was picked to finish 6th in the West. A&M and Auburn. The discrepancy in terms of the selections and the offseason momentum. Are people too low on A&M or too high on Auburn, Paul?
I think it's all about Will Muschamp, Joe, and I think so much attention. The moment he was hired, it seemed like Auburn was no longer an 8-5 team. They were a national championship contender. I think on A&M's side of the ball, John Chavis was a good hire. But we can't take our eyes off of Muschamp because before he became the Florida head coach, he was the best defensive coordinator in the game.
You look at Will Muschamp and you look at his resume. He's had great defenses everywhere when he's led them. You look at John Chavis. let's be honest. John Chavis was hired at Texas A&M because Texas A&M couldn't produce against LSU. And they wanted that guy to figure out how to stop the spread offense up-tempo. They gave up 20 points a game to A&M. No one else in the country could do that week in, week out. So they looked at film and said, if we can get this guy to come over with the offensive firepower that we have, we may have something here. But you pair Gus Malzahn with Will Muschamp, and Will stop people with all the offense. So what will he do when he's up 21 points? Exotic blitzes, put players in the right position to make plays. He'll look even better as a defensive coordinator with a lot of points being scored by his offense.
The hype around Auburn's justified, but people are way too low on Texas A&M. They have a quarterback coming back that is arguably one of the top five in the conference. They have maybe the best receiving core in the group. Their offensive line is always solid, and the defense now has a tenacity with John Chavis coming in and the urgency put into practice. They practice being more physical. They practice being more oriented in the scheme. They're more aggressive with their cornerbacks at the line of scrimmage. Now, I'm not saying they're going to blitz, and I don't think that defense is going to be in the top five in the league, but they will at least breathe some life and play with some energy and offense. Offensively, we talk about how one-dimensional they were last year. In comes Dave Christensen, new offensive line coach, new schemes in the run game, which should allow Kyle Allen bigger windows to throw the ball down the field. And you know that's a good recipe for success.
But Tiss, we talk parity now. You think about what you said about pairing Chavis up with this offense. Will with this offense in Auburn?
Let's talk about that offense.
I mean, that's uncanny now. Yeah. Teams are going to stay up late at night trying to figure that out.
I think the offense is next level at this point. And, Paul, I think that because of Jeremy Johnson now at quarterback. Nobody's better in this conference, Paul, than you in terms of sizing up the stock price of a team or a player. Jeremy Johnson's like one of these 90s tech IPOs right now.
But that's Auburn right now, Joe. I think they're a bubble stock. Listen, Greg made a great point. They're good. They're talented across the board. But they're not as good as Marcus made them out to be. They would be undefeated for the rest of mankind, Marcus. This is Auburn. They're coming off an 8-5 season. I don't want to keep saying that. Gus Malzahn made some mistakes last year. He's not the greatest coach of all time. He looked really bad in the red zone against Alabama, even though he said today, hey, we should have scored 60. We'll try getting a touchdown in the red zone. He's going to have the same challenge this year.
But Jeremy Johnson versus Nick Marshall, I mean, just so much more in terms of being vertical and stretching things.
I mean, I like Jeremy Johnson 10 times more than I like Nick Marshall. As far as throwing the ball, accuracy, the way he was able to lead receivers into holes, I love Jeremy Johnson. The problem is I've only seen a half of him. Right. And I want to get fired up about what he did against Arkansas, and I am. I'm really up on what Auburn can be with him at the helm. But I'm not going to get carried away and say that this guy is going to be the difference between an 8-5 record and a national championship. But with his offensive coordinator and Gus Malzahn at the helm, you have to assume he's going to do wonderful things.
Quarterbacks getting our attention when it comes to Auburn and Texas A&M. Quarterbacks were getting the attention of our expert voting panel. We asked them, top five SEC quarterbacks when it comes to this. Who will simply perform best this year? Dak, number one, safe pick. First team all SEC last year. But Josh Dobbs, skyrocketing with our expert panel. Number two right now on who will perform best this year. Paul, you're already signed.
You know, obviously, Marcus voted. Marcus is the only person on the panel that got a vote.
Marcus is like an old school Chicago voting box over there. He's stuffing that thing.
Mayor Daley, meet Marcus Spears.
Listen, seemingly absent from that list now for many years, of course, when it comes to that list of quarterbacks, the Florida Gators. It has been an offseason of change for Florida.
With the Gators cachet, it's about the fun and gun. It's about the offense, and they've been missing that.
My pleasure to introduce to you our new head football coach, Jim McElwain. Jim?
For us to be a part of Gator Nation is something that means so much.
And you can put this one in books. And they pick up the win here in the Birmingham Bowl.
Jim McElwain comes to Florida. He's able to develop relationships very quickly and haul in a pretty stellar class.
Think about the history and tradition that is Gator football. I cannot tell you how proud I am to be a part of that.
Of course, Greg, you were side by side with Coach Mack. He comes down near the Gainesville. I think Coach Mack's got a real good sense of what they are and what they aren't. What will be success for Jim McElwain this year at Florida?
Find a quarterback. Number one most important priority for Jim McElwain and Doug Nussmeier offensively. Find a guy that can move the chains. I don't care if it's Will Grier or Treon Harris. Find a leader. find someone capable enough, because over the last several seasons since Tim Tebow left Gainesville, they have not had a Sigma caller capable of carrying the team and then win seven games. They're going to say, look, we won seven games last year with an abysmal offense. But you know what? You lost four offensive linemen. The East has significantly improved, and you lost your best defensive player.
Yeah.
This is a rebuilding job. Seven games this year would be an outstanding foundation for Jim McElwain.
Well, it seems like a long time. We talk about success at quarterback. We'll go back to Tebow. Or we could go back to 1966 and Spurrier and have some similar conversations with his team. This year, right? South Carolina, Paul, find a quarterback, have a winning record, and then you add in a new defensive coordinator there as well.
And I think that is the key. I think John Hoke and Steve Spurrier, they worked together at Florida. I think that's the combination that Steve Spurrier has needed. Listen, he had a weird, and I mean a weird, offseason. His press conference a month ago was strange as I've seen from Coach Spurrier. In Birmingham, he was eloquent, and then he threw it all away. But he's got it back. He's uneven every day in practice, but it seems like the old ball coach is back. I know he likes to be called the head ball coach. He is the old ball coach.
Yeah,
he's 70
sure
years old.
What some of those comments were all about, struggling with quarterback play right now in fall camp for South Carolina. So Florida and South Carolina, Marcus, these two middling teams is the way they're being framed in the SEC East. Who will have the better season?
Well, when I think about South Carolina and Florida, same question you have, Greg. Who's the quarterback? Who's going to take over the offense and be the leader? I'm taking Florida. I think Florida's going to have a better season because of guys on the other side of the football. C.C. Jefferson coming in. Antonio Morrison, that linebacker, has the chance to be one of the best in the country. We know they have the best cover corner in the country in Vernon Hargraves. They have guys on the defensive side of the football that can actually change games. And Will Muschamp did it when he was there with an abysmal offense. The thing we don't know about South Carolina, how much improvement will be made on defense. We don't have that question with Florida.
Here's what we do know about South Carolina. They may have the best wide receiver in the SEC. So when Vernon Hargraves plays against them, he has to go up against Pharaoh Cooper. And Cooper was tops on the expert voting of impact pass catchers. Duke Williams and Treadwell tied for second. Ardarius Stewart getting a pop here. Alabama's Ardarius Stewart. They will need that as well if they want to have success. Ahead on the SEC Nation Preview Show, with all due respect to Duke, Dobbs, or Dak, is this the year of the running back? For Heisman, even. Could it be? We are talking SEC Heisman contenders. Plus, McElwain, the only new head coach, but new coordinators everywhere. Who will make?
You're talking about power when you talk about a running back like Leonard Fournette.
I don't care if you're calling the plays, or I'm calling the plays. Chubb is getting the ball.
We think he's going to be in the Heisman discussion.
First team All-SEC selection.
Hello, Leonard Fournette.
Chubb. Running over people.
Very difficult to be brought down. That's the type of run that gets your confidence going, gets the blood pumping.
You mentioned as one of the best college football players in the country this year, and I'm looking forward to seeing what he can do.
How about those guys for Super Softs? We asked our expert panel, SEC experts, for their top five running backs in terms of who will perform best, that dynamic duo on top, and then Derrick Henry. Javon Robinson, the JUCO transfer, with Rock Thomas having a great fall camp. Robinson makes the top five, and then obviously the vote taken before the news on Jonathan Williams, so perhaps maybe some will just slide Alex Collins onto that list. Greg, the last running back to win the Heisman Trophy?
That would be 2009.
You hand it off to him every single down. Mark Ingram. It's been a quarterback award, but with these running backs, could this be the breakthrough? You say there are top three Heisman candidates out of the SEC. The big reveal.
You mentioned could be the year of the running back in this conference, but it's the era of the quarterback. So I have to start with the leading prospect for the Heisman Trophy out of this conference, not named Amari Cooper, and Dak Prescott a year ago finished eighth. And he does so much for the team. And if he's able to shoulder the load and increase his level of play even more, he will absolutely deserve a spot in the Heisman Trophy finalist room, because he did so much for the team last year. It's just whether or not he has enough around him to be able to put together a win-loss record that could warrant a trip to New York.
You just hit on it. You know I study these historical trends and voting of the Heisman. You have to do better and you have to contend for it all. The new formula for winning the Heisman as a quarterback is be in the mix to play for it all. I'm assuming that's why you like Jeremy Johnson.
They have a chance to be there. With Will Muschamp coming in, that defense is going to be much better. This offensive formula with Nick Marshall at the helm, I thought, could have been much better with Jeremy Johnson because there were guys running all over the field wide open. Nick Marshall couldn't hit him in stride. Jeremy Johnson, with what we've seen, granted a small sample size, but knowing Rhett Lashley's history with quarterbacks and Gus Malzahn, what he's done with players at the position, you have to assume he's going to put up monster numbers.
All the great running backs in the SEC this year, your choice to go to New York and potentially get the hardware is Chubb.
So much about playing the running back position. It's about the guys up front. And when I look at the guys up front for the Georgia Bulldogs, they're as good as any in the conference. Look at the double team right here against the Louisville Cardinals. Look at the cutback, too, and watch the lead block, how Nick Chubb sets it up with his outside foot, and then the breakaway speed. He reminds me a lot of the most recent Heisman Trophy winner at the running back position, Mark Ingram, maybe a little more top-end speed. Watch the left side of the offensive line here. You can see the line of scrimmage clearly established at the 33. Now look at the new line of scrimmage, in some cases 4 yards downfield. Chubb absorbs blocks. He also finishes runs and knows the situation right there up late, stay in bounds. Watch the counterplay. Look at the agility by the offensive line and the way Chubb is able to break it to the outside on second and long, not necessarily a traditional running down. And then I love his patience and his ability to put his left foot in the ground and get vertical. The offensive line does a great job allowing him to get to the second level, but this is what I love so much about him, the way he turns 10-yard runs into 30-yard runs. We saw it time and time again last year, and with an expanded workload, I only expect him to get a little bit better after a year in the strength and conditioning program.
Give me a simple yes, no on this, because there is a statistical threshold now when it comes to running backs winning this, being up for the award.
Sure.
Does he rush for 2,000 yards?
Yes.
Then I think he's got a heck of a chance. Greg McElroy, if
they get breaking a new quarterback, they have some 2K. Weapons on the outside.
Oh,
he's
going to
have
new.
Some favorable boxes.
Something else is new with Georgia, a new offensive coordinator. In fact, coordinators all over the conference with changes, perhaps the most notable big change throughout the SEC.
No. Come on, Bryce. Come on.
Come to balance. Come on, push. Protect the football.
Well, when we decided to make a change, he was the first guy that I wanted.
He's had great success at really every level. He's coached a number of places in the NFL.
Clear that left foot, roll to the target each time, hit him in the face.
Our defensive players are really taking on his personality, and they're flying around like their hair's on fire.
It's fast paced. It's not going to get any faster than we're going right now. We're going to stop the run with numbers, and we're going to rush the passer with speed.
I don't care where they're from, who they are, and how many stars they got by their name. They need to go out there and compete every day.
Frankly, he makes them better. You know, he has the enthusiasm that you want.
1, 2, 3, drift! There you go. Good, nice ball. Come on, beat. Go! Nice. We should be 100 out of 100 here.
We got a team that's willing to work, and I tell you, it's been exciting watching them.
Well, yeah, we're throwing around the names of more coordinators than head coaches, it seems, today, because it is arguably the biggest storyline heading into the season. What impact will the new big name guys in the SEC have? Paul Marcus, I'm interested in your take on our experts panel here. Will Muschamp, and absolutely no surprise, leading this list. John Chavis at number 2. But then you got Brian Schottenheimer at Georgia and a 3-way tie for 4th in Nussmeier, Enos, and John Hope. Paul, what stands out to you when you look at this list?
Well, I think it's number 2. I mean, we talked about Will Muschamp, and we'll continue to talk about him. But John Chavis added to A&M. That's significant. But he also left LSU. I think that's as significant. And I don't think LSU replaced him very well. Kevin Steele has a nice resume. We all know about what he did at Florida State. We all know what he's done at Alabama. But his stock price lately is way down.
Marcus, just waiting to jump in here.
Kevin Steele and John Chavis are lifelong buddies. They grew up together. I don't think Kevin, from my conversations, we were down there earlier this spring, from my conversations with Coach Steele and also talking to Ed Ogeron, the new defensive line coach that they brought in, they understand that it's not broken at LSU. They understand that they have playmakers at every position, and they can be just as good as they were on defense last year. And that was his big thing. He said, candidly, Marcus, look, I don't need to come in and impose myself on this defense. I need to brush up on a few things, get the terminology that I like to use, convey to these guys, and let them go play. That's the type of talent that they have on defense. I think Kevin Steele will be just fine at LSU, just like I think Chavis will make A&M better. But LSU didn't lose a lot because both of these guys have been in a lot of conversations about how to play defense.
And for all the headlines Will Muschamp is making, he's not the only guy returning to a previous SEC West employer for a second go-round. How about Manny Diaz headed back to Starkville after a stint at Texas, an interesting stint there, and
well,
then
let
on
me,
to
let
Louisiana
me say it.
Tech.
It was a disastrous stint.
There we go. You can say it. But beyond Manny Diaz, Marcus, what must Mississippi State do to exceed the low expectations people have for him?
They have to hope that Dak is who he was last year and even better. He needs to become a better passer, and in turn, the whole team will feed off of that. This offense has some guys. Now, I like Daronya Wilson. I like the fact that they have an established quarterback. I think that's the great equalizer for Mississippi State. For any hope to have more success than we picked them for is that they have an experienced guy at the helm who's a leader, but also not to mention a guy that was in the race to win the Heisman Trophy last year.
That's nothing. They lost Collins to Florida. I don't know if they've replaced him. I think Florida got a great coordinator. I don't know about Mississippi
State. Defense is very important, and I think what Manny Diaz needs to understand, and like Dan Mullen has told us all offseason, a lot of these guys on this roster have a lot of experience of playing football from last year. So hopefully what he did with the substitution transfers last year translates into those guys not being big-eyed when they get into the game.
Does that O-line in front of Dak Prescott make you nervous, though?
It makes me very nervous. Losing so much, but what he does, you know, earlier we mentioned how Josh Dobbs makes Tennessee O-line better when he comes in the game. Dak has that ability, the ability to run and be multidimensional on offense to kind of hide some of those flaws that those guys have up front. I think they'll be just fine with Dak Prescott playing quarterback.
And we'll be just fine around here. Hey, still ahead on SEC Nation with quarterback competitions in Tuscaloosa and Athens. How much of the Tide and the Dogs' success hinges on the quarterback? Hey, and in Oxford, Ole Miss faithful cannot wait to see Laquon Treadwell return to the field. Why he could be faster and stronger.
I'm looking forward to Mississippi having a great day of football today.
Picked in the end zone by Sinquez Golson.
Prescott walks right into the Heisman discussion. Back-to-back victories over top 10 teams for the first time ever.
Another missed opportunity for Arkansas. Cross the field. Picked off. What a play by Landon Collins.
JoJo Kemp still going.
It's the JoJo Kemp show.
His third of the night.
And now he gets some assistance.
Tipped and picked by Dupree. This place is nuts.
And Bo Wallace has come on the field. Wallace runs around, fires far side into the end zone. Picked off. Game over. LSU is
going to
upset Ole Miss.
Ah, yes, the separation games in October. Our expert panel voted. These are the top five separation games in October. Notice the common theme. Georgia at Tennessee. Georgia hosting Alabama. Georgia hosting Missouri. As we welcome you back here to our SEC Nation preview show with two SEC champions and one SEC championship pot stirrer. Georgia's schedule and the quarterback situation, too much to overcome?
Not necessarily, because when I look at Grayson Lambert, I look at his supporting cast that he had when he was with Virginia. And frankly, Virginia has not had an offensive skill position player drafted since 2009, and that player was Cedric Pierman in the sixth round. He did not have a supporting cast. When he goes to Georgia, he's going to have the benefit of a running game on his side. The defense will be extremely good. Yes, his stats aren't going to jump out at you, what he did while he was with the Cavaliers.
Is he going to be the starter?
Yes, he will be the starter.
It feels like it's still a competition with Bryce Ramsey.
It's definitely still a competition, but I think if Mike Bobo was the OC,
yeah,
Bryce Ramsey would be the starter. But with a clean slate, Grayson Lambert was brought in for a reason. There is a reason why Brian Schottenheimer saw him, noted him, and wanted him on campus taking part in this quarterback.
So you just picked the starter?
I think that's going to be who it is.
I got you. I think it's the schedule. I think
well, look at what we just put up for October.
I think what they have to do on the road, and what do we know about Georgia in recent history? They have a time in the season where they'll lapse and they'll drop one that they're not supposed to lose. Now, I think this year may be different, but we've said that the previous 3 years. But these guys running the gauntlet between – South Carolina game won't be easy. It wasn't easy last year for them, as bad as we thought South Carolina may be. Then you go Alabama, Tennessee, at Missouri – versus Florida. We don't know what Florida will be, but those are hard games to win. They have a gauntlet there that they have to run, starting with Alabama, that Georgia is known for having one of those days where it's like, we don't want to play today.
Paul, we talk about Georgia every year this way, don't
I get so tired of hearing the same thing every year about Mark Richt, because unfortunately, it's true. he's very difficult to defend, but I do think this is a different year in Georgia. I think if Greg is correct, and I'm not going to doubt him, I think Georgia is in excellent shape to win the East.
Greg says otherwise at the quarterback position, but for many, Georgia is just one of the TBA quarterback situations in the SEC.
Several teams still unsettled at starting quarterback. Some big name programs, high expectation programs.
Well, we got some new players. We got some players that were there in the spring. They're all competing. We don't have a depth chart now.
And there's questions at quarterback. If they get answers there, they could be another 11, 12, 13, 14 win season.
Starting first is not as important as finishing first. Whoever's our quarterback should be a dominant player, somebody that is looking to serve the team.
Other than Mississippi State, Tennessee's got Dobbs coming back. Just about everybody else has some type of question at quarterback.
We're going to rotate the top three guys and just keep rotating them around on a day-to-day basis until we think we need to stop.
All are going to get reps with the ones, for sure. I don't know that I can overstate the importance of our quarterback situation.
That quarterback situation is going to take care of itself. I don't plan on playing four quarterbacks, three quarterbacks. There'll be a starter, there'll be a backup.
Quarterback battle is going on. Like I told him, we're charting everything. We've turned into a bunch of charters out here.
Any of the quarterbacks stand out? Any one stand out today?
I don't know.
We're going into the great unknown here. We don't know what this is going to look like, who the quarterback's going to be, whether he'll finish the season.
Somebody's going to take a snap first play. I don't know who it is yet. As soon as we know, we'll let you know.
I'm only wondering what Connor Mitch's parents are thinking right now as you listen to Steve Spurrier. Anyways, seven teams have a quarterback. Seven teams still haven't decided. That's where we stand right now. And, of course, the quarterback battle ongoing at Alabama. Whatever happened to that Jake Coker conversation of 2014 spring? Here we are, still with it. Bama's success, how dependent is it on having that one guy that can get it done?
Very dependent. That's the era of college football that we live in right now. It's a quarterback-driven game at this point. And really, last year, Blake Sims didn't do a ton at the line of scrimmage, but he alleviated concerns when it came to pass rush by his creating as he escaped the pocket. This year, it doesn't look like any of these quarterbacks that are vying for the spot have that type of athletic ability. So they're going to have to rely more on their acumen and knowledge of the offense. That's where you would look at Jake Coker. He hasn't grabbed on yet. Maybe you go with the younger guy as a result.
Of course, this guy would say, yeah, you can always lean on those running backs and that defense a bit, right, Marcus?
Absolutely. I think when you look at Alabama, Alabama was built on running the football. That's the great teams that we think about at the University of Alabama. They never were 3,500 yards passing per year. I think a quarterback, that whoever they choose, needs to be serviceable. He needs to be a guy that doesn't turn the football over, can move the chains on some third and longs and get them in position to score touchdowns. But with Derrick Henry, this offensive line, and the stock that we've put in this defense in this front seven, Alabama will be just fine. They have to run up against Auburn, though, and that's my only issue with this season.
Coker, Cornwell, Barnett, Morris. Well, how deep are we going to go here?
Feinbaum.
I think I just started for this team.
Matt, go back.
No, I don't know about that.
They dream for that.
But that's Alabama. They had probably A.J. McCarron's last 2 years, but other than that, and Greg's 2010 year, it's always a circus when it comes to the quarterback position at Alabama.
Ole Miss won the ESPY for best upset. Nobody's really talking about Ole Miss the way we were in the middle of last season. Why the lower expectations with Ole Miss?
Because there's questions at the quarterback position. But when you look at their quarterback last year,
I didn't think Bo Wallace was very good. Last time I checked, I thought he actually played them out of game.
Around Hugh Freeze now.
That's fine. I'll say it to anybody because I don't think he played well enough. And especially if you look at some of the games he had, particularly against LSU, he really struggled. And Arkansas as well, where he's throwing it up for grabs. I know he was banged up, but that's the question mark around Ole Miss. But much like Alabama, there's so many talented players on the outside at wide receiver. Yes, we know about Laquon Treadwell, Evan Ingram, DeMaurier Stringfellow, who hasn't even played for the Ole Miss Rebels yet, who's a big body receiver that is very capable. On defense, you want to talk about Cody Pruitt being gone, Senquez Golson, both unanimous All-Americans at one point or another. They bring in two corners that are 6'1". Tony Connor's the best safety in the league. This defense is going to be fantastic. And I think Ole Miss, a lot of people are sleeping on him, probably because of the quarterback position, but I think it's unwarranted.
Of course, maybe the revenge game down there in T-Town after that.
They need to establish a run game.
Best upset. You brought up Laquon Treadwell, obviously returning from the injury. Kaylee recently spoke with Laquon.
Better, faster, stronger. That's how Laquon Treadwell described how he feels back on the field this summer. And it wasn't just hubris talking. That characterization was echoed by Hugh Freeze and several of his teammates. Treadwell dropped weight through rehab, and he added strength. His commitment to the recovery process over the past 9 months was exhibited through early mornings of treatment and late nights of agility work. There were nights he even slept at the facility so he could maximize his time there. After dislocating his ankle and fracturing his leg, he explained to me that the biggest challenge through rehab was becoming comfortable making cuts. Once he got over the hump of planting his foot, he was off to the races, literally. It was during a 7-on-7 workout this summer that Treadwell assured himself and his team that their best offensive weapon would be back without limitation this fall. That's a welcome sight in Oxford, Mississippi, Tess.
Boy, it sure is. He's so talented, Laquon Treadwell. Of course, Ole Miss was top five in the country. LSU got them in that low-scoring game. And now here we are again with similar storylines for LSU. The quarterback position, the tough schedule, Jennings or Harris. Where are we with your Tigers, Mr. Spears?
I think it'll be Brandon Harris. I mean, Anthony Jennings had his run in this offseason. I think that gave Brandon Harris the leg up. But they know what the full body of work from Anthony Jennings looks like. I think they need to give Brandon Harris an opportunity to get his legs under him early in the season, see what he can do as a leader on the football field, and he'll establish himself as the starter.
Paul, I want to show you the schedule for LSU here because I want to have this discussion. We were talking about this the other day. We could be 3 weeks in and know everything we need to know about LSU because look at when you see at Mississippi State and then Auburn. I mean, big difference between 3-0 with those two wins and 1-2 and the things that'll be said.
Joe, they already have a restless fan base. And what if LSU loses at Mississippi State? It's very possible. We know what happened last year. And then Auburn comes in there and is good as everyone says they are. You're talking about 1-2, and the Boo Birds trying to get rid of Les Miles would be loud.
Indeed, and SEC Nation will be there for that game week three. And we know it'll be loud. That's just the way we like it. All right, 3-and-out here. 3-and-out to the commercial break. Give me a reason to believe, Paul, a reason to believe that Mizzou wins their third straight SEC East.
I think it has more to do with Georgia and Tennessee. If Georgia and Tennessee don't quite live up, then I think Missouri, hate to say it, will backdoor into Atlanta once
Stop
again.
Stop saying backdoor. They earned it. All right, Joe.
They backdoored last year.
Marcus, reason to believe that Vandy is much improved.
I think Derek Mason going and call defense is a big deal for Vanderbilt. He's tried to recruit guys that formulate in that 3-4 type system where he can be extravagant on defense and be in his wheelhouse. He'll be more comfortable. And pick one quarterback.
Yeah.
And stick with him.
Listen, that thing unraveled very early last year with all four of them playing on that Thursday nighter that I think is still being played right now against Temple. Greg, reason to believe that Kentucky will be bowl-bound.
Because they brought Shannon Dawson in, an offensive coordinator. And Shannon Dawson will finally get the opportunity to run his own show. At West Virginia, under Dana Holgorsen, he didn't necessarily always get to call the plays. He formulated game plans. But now he has the opportunity to put his fingerprints on a very talented quarterback in Patrick Toles. And that offense is going to be very explosive.
Let it be known that the two of us voted Shannon Dawson on that expert poll for impact coordinators, and he didn't show up in that top five, and that's a mistake, and it's going to be proven this year. Completely agree with you. Hey, last year we gave you a pair of receivers that ended up being stars out of nowhere.
ahead. Six more names you need to know. The pick six coming up. The need to know guys. Plus, which teams have the playoff potential? Our experts weigh in on who could be in. Welcome back to the SEC Nation Preview Show, our road show presented by AT&T. Get started on Saturday, September 5th, 10 a.m. Eastern from Arkansas. We're starting off with the Hogs, a new season of SEC Nation presented by AT&T. Listen, there is no conference like the SEC when it comes to hyping up established stars. There's also no conference like the SEC when it comes to taking unknowns and making them well-known. And with that, I offer up my pick six. Players we're not talking about right now, but I have the feeling we are going to be talking about plenty come midseason. And we'll start with a Hog. Arkansas linebacker Brooks Ellis. He's my sleeper pick to lead the SEC in tackles. Their defensive coordinator Rob Smith has a scheme that allows for the weak side linebacker to run free. That was Martrell Spate last year. He had 128 tackles. Brooks Ellis now fills that role. Expect him to be the Hog that we're discussing nonstop. And how about my long shot pick six? Kentucky wide receiver Dorian Baker. Their new offensive coordinator Shannon Dawson loves to have a big downfield threat. Baker is strong, impressive, a 6'3 sophomore. Watch out for that Kentucky offense. They're going to click with Baker. We all know about the Heisman hype for Nick Chubb. But remember, Keith Marshall is back healthy. Remember Herschel, the combined nickname with Todd Gurley? That was applied in Athens not long ago. Chubb's going to star, but Marshall could be the X factor for Georgia's offense. And as is always the case in the SEC, top freshman talent will emerge. It's already been happening on Rocky Top. Tennessee's massive freshman defensive lineman Khalil McKenzie, every bit the top prospect he was touted as, McKenzie will play a role on a unit that needs him to be a force. The other freshman is from DBU, LSU's Kevin Tolliver, a real opportunity to hit the field opposite their star corner Tre'Davious White. Don't be surprised if LSU goes with him right out of the gate. He was an early enrollee who has been very impressive. And Tolliver's emergence could make for an interesting freshman matchup in November, because my other pick six is Alabama's Calvin Ridley. Nick Saban tried to curb the excitement over Ridley recently, but there's no denying he's as talented a freshman as we've seen in a long recent list of talented freshman receivers. Of course, Alabama lost all three starting receivers a year ago. Cam Sims out with the ACL, and Lane Kiffin. That system often rewards a precocious receiver. The number one defense in the country against the number three offense in the country. Auburn Ole Miss, this is an elimination game.
Quick throw. Treadwell weaving through. That didn't look good at the end of the play.
They lost one of their very best players, and they're going to lose the football game.
Dobbs to scramble. We've got an 8-point game. Dobbs into touchdown, Tennessee! And a hard-fought, heartfelt victory for the Volunteers.
Sims, the Andrew White touchdown. And Alabama in overtime.
Touchdown, Missouri. They're back to Atlanta for the SEC Championship.
Saban and the Bama staff, they've got a decision to make.
Sims, Cooper's got it. Touchdown, Alabama.
What can you say about Blake Sims in the second half?
This is Walton.
Oh my goodness. Walton is going to go all the way.
Those games that will lead to a championship. The SEC expert panel voted, and the Iron Bowl was the only unanimous selection on the entire ballot of the SEC Nation panel. But you see Auburn showing up a lot. Of course, Georgia at Auburn. Auburn at Texas A&M is a sneaky game that could really twist and turn things when it comes to the SEC West. Tennessee, Mizzou, you know the influence it played last year. No. Late drama in that game. And then LSU, Alabama. I mean, that's required viewing. Always there. But we will see what happens there. All right, so the college football playoff, the who's into the four. We opened up this broadcast talking about the new paradigm. And boy, the BCS treated the SEC really well. We're 1 year in, a sample size that's small, but perhaps not as well, the college football playoff. Name the teams you truly believe can make the college football playoff from the SEC.
I believe there's four
okay.
that can actually get there this year because of their play at the line of scrimmage and their defensive potential. Alabama, defensive front seven, as good as anybody in the country, rock solid at line, rock solid at running back, great in the secondary after they've improved this year. Auburn, Georgia, and Arkansas. My dark horse in the SEC West because of the way they dominate the line of scrimmage and they can close you out. A lot of teams in this conference can't close you out because they lack the supporting capabilities of a run game. I like Arkansas.
Alabama, because defense usually wins championships. Ohio State won it on defense, as much as people like to believe. Auburn, because I think Jeremy Johnson, they infused something into that offense and defensively will Muschamp. Georgia, Nick Chubb. Is it the year? Is it the year they get over the hump and don't drop the one they're not supposed to? And then my fourth pick is LSU. Because LSU is as talented as any team in the SEC.
Paul, your teams that you really think can get to the playoff from the SEC.
It's prosaic to say the winner of the Iron Bowl because six straight years, the winner of that game has played a major role in the national championship. But that's LSU, did you say?
Yes, sir.
So you say there's one team.
It's the winner of the Iron Bowl and no one else.
I'm going to go to the other extreme and say there are eight because I think anybody can win the SEC West. No, listen.
Including
anybody
LSU.
Anybody can win the SEC West. And Georgia, I believe, will win the SEC East. And that's how I come up with eight potential teams. Folks, we are off and running with SEC Nation. Week one's going to be Arkansas. Week two will be at Vandy. Week three, LSU Auburn.
Can't wait.
Come out and see us. We're starting with Arkansas. Hogs. We're calling the Hogs. Week one.